Chinese EV products right now. They are very, very good.
A new electric vehicle has arrived in Australia that costs under $25,000.
Might not realize how much it's actually costing them.
How much it's actually costing them.
In 2024, more than one in five new passenger cars sold worldwide was electric. That's about 22% of global sales, according to the World Resource Institute. 5 years ago, it was closer to 3%. Impressive numbers, sure, but numbers don't tell you whether the system can actually handle it. A shift like that usually takes decades. This one is happening in real time. Now look closer. In Norway, almost every new car sold is electric. In China, EVs make up nearly half of all new car sales, with millions sold every year. Even more surprising, countries like Ethiopia, Nepal, and Sri Lanka are skipping gasoline altogether. In some of these markets, most imported cars are already electric. Not for climate reasons, but because fuel imports are too expensive and unstable. But here is part most people miss. Going 100% electric isn't about replacing engines. It means rebuilding the entire system, battery production, critical minerals, charging networks, power grids, electricity prices, and of course political decisions. One bottleneck can slow everything down. So here is a real question. Can the world really go 100% electric, or is it just a dream? Tell us your opinion in the comments below before we continue. And don't forget to hit like, subscribe, and share this video. The final place of this puzzle changes everything you think you know about going electric. For years, the story sounded simple. Electric cars were a rich world obsession, limited to Europe, California, and few climate-conscious cities. But the story is already outdated.
According to Bloomberg and CSS data, the fastest growth in electric vehicles is now happening in emerging markets, and the pace is described as breathtaking. In developing countries, plug-in vehicle sales jumped by around 60% in a single year. China grabs most of the headlines, but the real surprise is what's happening next door. In Vietnam, the domestic EV maker VinFast accounted for more than a third of all car sales in just the first half of the year. Turkey's fully electric vehicle share hit around 13%, roughly double that of Spain or Australia. In Indonesia, EV sales share is already similar to the United States. This isn't about status or climate virtue. In many of these countries, fuel imports swallow a huge share of national budgets. In places like India and Pakistan, oil and gas can make up close to a third of all merchandise imports. Electric vehicles flip that equation, because instead of sending money abroad for fuel, countries spend more at home on electricity, jobs, and infrastructure.
That's why the Global South isn't waiting to follow the West. In many cases, it's leapfrogging it, as simple as it sounds. If anyone still doubts how fast an electric transition can happen, Norway ends that debate. In 2024, electric vehicles made up about 92% of all new passenger cars sold there.
Just a decade ago, EVs were a niche. The change didn't happen because Norwegians are uniquely green. It happened because the math flipped. High taxes on gasoline cars, generous incentives for EVs, dense charging networks, and everyday convenience pushed electric cars past a tipping point where they simply became the better option. China shows what happens when that model is scaled up. In 2024, China sold around 11.3 million electric vehicles, with EVs accounting for roughly 48% of all new car sales. That's more than the rest of the world combined. China didn't wait for the market to move on its own. It invested early in batteries, factories, charging infrastructure, and domestic brands, driving prices down and choice up. Today, electric cars in China are often cheaper than gasoline models. Together, Norway and China reveal the same pattern. EV adoption follows an S-curve. At first, growth is slow and uncertain. Then a tipping point is reached, and adoption accelerates rapidly.
After that, saturation comes fast. Once the curve bends upward, there is no going back. If the world ever reaches 100% electric, it won't be decided by hype. It will be decided by four hard bottlenecks.
First is affordability. Price beats ideology every time. McKinsey finds only about one-third of consumers are willing to buy an EV at today's prices. But when EV prices match gasoline cars, willingness jumps to over 50%. In China, where many EVs are already cheaper than ICE cars, adoption surged rapidly. Second is charging and time. What people call range anxiety is usually charging anxiety. McKinsey surveys show range and charging speed remain the top global concerns. Most buyers want roughly 500 kilometers of real-world range and charging under 30 minutes. Third is the power grid. Despite popular fear, grids don't collapse overnight. Statcraft notes that existing grids can handle far more EVs, especially if charging is shifted to off-peak hours and managed smartly. Timing matters more than raw capacity. Finally, supply chains decide speed. Batteries need lithium, nickel, factories, and stable geopolitics. Scale them smoothly and prices fall. Disrupt them, and the transition slows everywhere.
These four factors decide whether 100% electric stays a goal or becomes reality. Electric cars are cleaner, but they are not magic, and that distinction matters. Common myth says that EVs are no better for the climate once you count electricity and manufacturing, but is it actually true?
Life cycle studies from the US EPA show the opposite. Even when charged on electricity grids that still use fossil fuels, electric vehicles usually produce lower total emissions over their lifetime than gasoline cars. But that doesn't mean EVs are impact-free. Battery production is energy-intensive and depends on mining lithium, nickel, and cobalt, which can damage ecosystems and strain water supplies. Recycling is improving, but it is not yet perfect or universal. These are real environmental costs, and ignoring them weakens the case for electrification rather than strengthening it. The key question is scale and time. Once an EV is on the road, emissions drop sharply. According to ICCT research, battery electric cars sold in Europe today produce about 73% lower lifecycle greenhouse gas emissions than comparable gasoline cars.
As power grids get cleaner and recycling improves, that gap keeps widening. Reaching 100% electric sounds simple until you look at what's already on the road.
Even if nearly all new cars sold tomorrow were electric, the global vehicle fleet would still take years, even decades, to fully turn over. Cars last a long time, and hundreds of millions of gasoline vehicles won't disappear overnight. Politics makes this harder. In Europe, EV demand dipped sharply when purchase subsidies were reduced or removed, showing how sensitive buyers still are to policy changes. In the United States, adoption varies wildly by region. McKinsey finds that EV purchase intent is above 50% in places like California, but below 20% in many southern and midwestern states. This uneven landscape slows a uniform transition. That's where hybrids come in. Plug-in hybrids and extended-range EVs act as bridge technologies. McKinsey notes that in markets with weak charging networks or long-distance driving needs, hybrids remain highly attractive.
They lower fuel use, reduce emissions, and help hesitant buyers move closer to full electrification. New sales can flip fast, fleets flip slow. So, can the world really go 100% electric? For new car sales, the answer in some countries is already yes. Norway is effectively there, with electric vehicles making up the vast majority of new sales. China is close behind, selling millions of EVs a year and pushing toward half of all new cars being electric. This part of the transition is no longer theoretical. It's happening now. But electrifying the entire global vehicle fleet is a much harder challenge. That outcome is possible, but it isn't guaranteed. The real limits aren't electric motors. They are prices people can afford, chargers people can trust, power grids that can handle demand, and supply chains that can scale without breaking. If any of these fails, the transition slows. What's the biggest blocker where you live? High prices, lack of chargers, weak grids, or politics? Let us know in the comments below. And don't forget to hit like, subscribe, and share this video so you don't miss our upcoming videos. Catch you in the next one.